भैया म्यूट।
यस सर।
संदीप का स्क्रीन ऑन करो,
वी आर लाइव।
इसमें स्क्रीनशॉट
एज इन
वी आर लाइव।
आई ओके आई स्टार्ट। हेलो एवरीवन, होप यू आर सेफ एंड डूइंग वेल। आई थैंक यू ऑल फॉर एनरोलिंग टू टुडेज इवेंट। वी आर बैक विद अ न्यू सेशन on EIE Fresh Talk presented by Excel in Excel. A company started in 2010 as an edutech firm and over time expanded into data analysis. We strongly believe that for a world driven by data, information is power and excellence is our brand. Our core services include analytics, consulting, training. Let me give you a gist on EIE Fresh Talk. It is a platform where we host great leaders and experts from various fields to speak regularly on a variety of topics, ranging from finance to analytics. Few of our past events are by CAV Pattabhi Ram, CAMP Vijay Kumar, Ms. Daniel, Mr. Chandu. Our topic for today's session is Modeling a Franchise Business Opportunity by CA Sandeep Kothari. Mr. Sandeep is a practicing chartered accountant based out of Chennai and a trainer for professional courses such as CFA and financial modeling. He has over 11 years of corporate experience and 4 years of teaching experience. He possesses rich and varied industry experience working in equity research, credit research, and financial reporting with leading corporates. He completed his BCom from Loyola College in 2005, chartered accountant from ICAI in 2007, Diploma in IFRS from ACCA in 2010, and CFA from ICFA US in 2014. We welcome you, sir. Before we begin, I request the participants to welcome our speaker by writing hi in the chat section. I also request you to type in your questions or any comments in the chat section. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shreyans, and welcome all of you for my session today on basics of financial modeling. Give me a minute, I'll share my screen.
Sandeep, you can share your screen.
Yeah, I'm doing that.
Shreyans, you can stop. Good, we can see it.
Yeah. So our topic for today is financial modeling basics, and we would be taking up a business which is of a quick service restaurant. So you can see over here QSR franchise, and what we mean by QSR franchise is a quick service restaurant or a fast food as we commonly call it. So we take up a business model of a quick service restaurant and try to evaluate whether it makes sense for us to go ahead with that particular business franchise or not, right? So the agenda, I'll just quickly set up the context before we get into the slides. And there are very few slides, 4 or 5 slides. So you don't have to really worry about too much of slides being bombarded on you. So we'll just look at what is a franchise and how does a franchise work. I have a very short case study post that where we'll quickly see how franchise model has helped a lot of global businesses scale up across the world. And they've benefited massively. So I've taken up one short case study, which we'll look at. And post that, we'll quickly get into the financial model that we're going to build today. And towards the end, we'll also take up the Q&As relating to our today's topic. So let's get started. What is a franchise? So I'm sure most of you would already be aware what a franchise means, but let's just quickly run through it for the benefit of others as well. So in a franchise, there are typically two parties, a franchisor and a franchisee. So franchisor is the owner of a brand, or as you can see, proprietary knowledge or a process or a trademark. And franchisee is a person who would take these rights to use these brands or proprietary knowledge or process or trademarks and sell products under the name of these trademarks or proprietary knowledge. So this license to use the brand of a franchisor given to the franchisee is known as a franchise. So if you were to ask me one of the most common example of franchisee that probably all of us would be knowing, I would say there's the petrol pumps. As you can see, the petrol pumps like Indian Oil and HP and BP. So most of these petrol pumps generally operate on a franchise basis where the company takes care of the marketing, brand creation, production, and all of that. And sales is taken care of by the people who own the petrol pumps, who are different from the company. So these people who own the petrol pumps are typically the franchisees. And the companies like Indian Oil, BP, and HP, these are the franchises. So you might ask a question, why would someone like to give rights to use his brand, his or her brand, to someone else? There are multiple reasons for it. And one of the most common reason is when the company is interested to increase its market share. So this is one of the ways where you can increase your market share without really investing too much of money into the business, right? So we all know today's world is all driven by asset-light business models. So this franchise model would typically help companies to remain asset-light, where their investments into the assets would be limited and they would give rights to use their brands. The companies will focus more on innovation, on creation of the products, marketing, centralized efforts would be put on all of that. And the local efforts of making sales or other selling the products would be taken care by the franchisees. So that's the reason a franchisor would be interested to let others use his brands and make sales of the products. What is the benefit for franchisee in this process? So franchisee would also benefit massively in this process because he gets access to this established brand name. Now, he doesn't have to really go and spend time and efforts in creating the brand value all over again. He doesn't have to start from the scratch. That brand value is already created. The quality of the products is already known to the people. He just has to start establishing the market and start selling the products in the market. So that way, both it's a win-win for both the franchisee and the franchisor. And how do these agreements typically reward both of them? So for a franchisor, the reward would be in two ways. One would be initially when the franchisee takes the franchise rights from the franchisor, he would have to pay an initial startup fee, which would be paid upfront when they take the get these rights to use the brand name. And secondly, they also need to pay on an ongoing basis, typically on a yearly basis or a monthly basis, a percentage, certain percentage of the sales which the franchisee generates. So franchisor would usually get two kinds of payouts from this arrangement. The first one would be the initial startup fee, and the second one would be something which we could call as royalty. That would be paid annually on the basis of sales. So these are the two ways he gets rewarded. Franchisee, of course, we saw he gets rewarded because he gets to use the brand name, which has been created with so much of years and efforts of the franchisor. So that said, let's get into the case study for today. So I have picked up a case study of McDonald's, and I'm sure all of you would have gone to the McDonald's restaurant. It's not a new name. So this is a US company. So before I get into the case study, I have two questions for the audience. My first question, though I might sound a little silly here, is I want to ask you guys, what is the business of McDonald's? Can you put in the YouTube chat, what is the business of McDonald's? What business is McDonald's into? You can type your answers in the YouTube chat. This might sound a silly question, but there is a learning involved in this. So that's the reason I'm asking. So can you put in your YouTube chat, what is the business McDonald's does? Yes, please respond in the YouTube chat, what business is McDonald's into? Okay, I can see a couple of answers here. Food and beverage, selling fast food, food delivery. Okay, good. My second question, it's not a question, rather a guess. So I want you guys to make a guess. How much percentage of stores or restaurants which McDonald's operates do you think are operated on a franchise basis? So let's say if there are 100 restaurants which McDonald's operates, how much percentage of those restaurants do you think McDonald's gives on franchise basis? Which means the owners are different, owners of these stores are different, who operate the stores are different from McDonald's. Can you again type in the chat box, what percentage do you think is the franchise stores for McDonald's? Okay, please type your answers in the chat box. Okay, so all of you have mentioned 100%. That's quite a huge number. So let's go to the next slide and get answers to our questions. So the business of McDonald's. There are two comments that I've taken from the management or executives of McDonald's. You can see at the bottom. So the founder of McDonald's, Ray Kroc, he says, "My business is real estate." Right. So to the contrary to the common belief that McDonald's is in the business of selling burgers and food and beverage and fast food, etc., the founders, they claim that we are into the business of real estate. Similarly, there's another comment that I've taken, which was made by former McDonald's CFO. So let's read through that as well. "We are not technically in the food business. We are in the real estate business. The only reason we sell 15-cent hamburgers is because they are the greatest producer of revenue from which our tenants can pay us our rent," right? So you see what the business model that they operate in. They are essentially into the business of real estate, and they let their franchisees sell burgers so that they can get money by selling these burgers and in turn pay rent to them, right? So that is how the business model of McDonald's works. So how they operate in US is basically they own these properties or restaurants. So the either they take them on lease or they own these properties by themselves. McDonald's does that. And the people who take the franchise rights would have to lease these properties from McDonald's. So that would be at a huge markup. So in this case, apart from the initial fee and the royalties, McDonald's also gains from the rent. So they charge a huge rent to the store, the franchisees who operate these stores. And coming to the second question, which was how much percentage of their stores are operated on a franchise basis. So most of you said 100%. So that's a really good guess, I would say. So I was expecting you would guess a lower number, but you guessed 100%. Now the company's 2019 annual report, they say that 93% of their total capacity is operated on the basis of franchise, right? And the long-term goal is to take that to 95%, which means of the 100 stores, 100 restaurants, which are operated by McDonald's, only 5% would be owned by them and 95% would be operated on a franchise basis. So how has franchise benefited, this franchise business model benefited McDonald's? Look at the fourth bullet point in this slide. McDonald's emerged as the most valuable quick service restaurant brand with a value nearing USD 130 billion. So I'll take you to the next slide where I've captured the most valuable fast food brands worldwide. And this is the data of 2019. So very recent data. If you look at McDonald's, it is leading the chart and it has a brand value of almost 130 billion, sorry. And followed by Starbucks, KFC. I mean, out of these 10, if you look at out of these 10, most of the brands, you would already have seen the store, at least in metros in India, right? So majority of them, they operate on franchise basis and they've been able to create huge brand value for themselves by operating in this model. So let's get to the core discussion of ours today, which is to build a franchise financial model. Now, if you were that lucky person who has been given an opportunity by McDonald's to open a franchised store on behalf of them, how would you look at that particular business opportunity? How would you evaluate that business opportunity? That's the agenda for our day. So what would be exactly the steps which you need to work on to build a model? So these are the four steps I've listed here. So not necessarily that every financial model would have these four steps, but these are the steps, four steps which are relevant to our discussion today. So I've noted them down over here. The first step, I would say this is one of the most important steps of all, is to define the assumptions. So our financial modeling exercise would typically start with defining the assumptions. So when we say assumptions, what would be those assumptions like? In our example, the assumptions could be to figure out how much is the revenue which you're going to forecast for the life of this project. And how much would be the expenses? What are the different kinds of expenses which would be incurred? And how much would those expenses be? What could be the initial investments that would be required to be made in this business? And so on. So as we all know, this concept of garbage in, garbage out. So the output of the model, the quality of the output of the model would be largely dependent on the quality of the inputs that we make. And that is the assumptions. Now, how do we get these assumptions? So there are various ways by these assumptions would be or could be derived. So for example, if you are working in a corporate, you're working in a corporate finance department and your job is to evaluate different projects, so it is highly likely that most of the operating assumptions that are required to be made for a financial model would be provided to you by the different departments within the organization. So there might be a marketing team, sales team, there might be a production team. They would give you the data that you require for your financial model. So your job would then be to appropriately collate the data and model it and give the output, right? But in a scenario like this, where we are going to evaluate a business opportunity for ourselves, we do not have anyone who's going to come and give us the information. So probably we'll have to be more creative, more innovative to figure out how we could collect these data that we need. How should we structure our model? And then we can go and derive the output out of it. So the first step would be defining the assumptions. The second step would be to compute the revenues, costs, and profits. Once you have your assumptions in your hand, typically in a financial model, we prepare a three financial statement model wherein we have an income statement, we have a balance sheet, and a cash flow statement. For our today's discussion, given the time constraint, I would only be preparing a short P&L and we'll compute the cash flows. So ideally, if you were to prepare a detailed model, we would also prepare balance sheet, cash flow statement, and all of that. So we need to start by plotting the revenues and expenses and derive the profits. That would be our second step. Third step is to compute the cash flows. Now, why do I need cash flows and what are cash flows? Are they different from profits? Yes, they are very much different from profits because while computing the profits, that could be based on accrual concept. Right? So we know accounting is done on accrual concept. So there, if the profit that we get in our P&L would be on the accrual basis. And secondly, it might also involve a lot of non-cash charges. So we need to compute the cash flows, which would be to eliminate these non-cash charges to figure out the actual cash that is coming in into the business. Right? So why do we need to compute these cash flows? Why cannot we evaluate the business just on the basis of profit? Now, from an owner's perspective or from an investor's perspective, what would he be interested in? He would look at the cash that is going out initially out of his pocket into the business. And then he would see how much cash is he getting over the life of the project. That is what would be a meaningful evaluation of a project. He might be interested to see how much profits he's earning in this business model, but definitely the most important part of his evaluation would be the cash flows that the project is generating for him. So he'll see what is the initial cash that is going out and what is the cash he's generating over the life of the project. And that would help him to make a meaningful evaluation of the project. So once you've done the cash flow computation, the last step would be to use capital budgeting tools and make the decision whether this project is feasible or not feasible. So why do we need capital budgeting tools? We already have the cash flows with us. Why do we need to do this last step? So the reason is the cash outflow that has happened for the investor is at present money terms. Whereas the inflow in this case, for example, we would assume that sites would be for 20 years. So you would be making cash inflows over the next 20 years. So are these cash inflows, for example, cash that I would earn in year 10, would that be comparable with the cash that I've invested at year zero? I'm investing some X amount today and I would be earning some other amount in year 10. Are they both comparable? No, they're not comparable because of the time value of money involved. So the money that we get later has a lower value today. So capital budgeting tools like IRR, the internal rate of return, and NPV, net present value, these are the tools that would help us to bring both cash outflows and inflows in same money terms, in today's money terms, and tell us how much of return are we exactly earning on this particular project, right? So that's the reason we need the capital budgeting tools to finally make our decision. Just looking at the cash, it would be difficult to make a right decision. The capital budgeting tools would really give us a meaningful insights into or whether this project is feasible or not. So I'll take you through the assumptions that I've made for my quick service restaurant model. So we'll evaluate this burger franchise, McDonald's. It's not McDonald's, I wantedly put it as McDonald's. So this is the franchise or restaurant that I'm going to open. And I've tried to figure out a little bit through various sources, through Google and all, how this franchise business of McDonald's operates. So I've incorporated many of the assumptions from there. And then there's also another source which I've used to get a lot of these assumptions. So what I would do is, I would take you through all the assumptions first. Let's look at all the assumptions that I've made. And then towards the end, I would also explain you how I've made sure that these assumptions are reasonable and they make sense, right? So we'll first look at the assumptions. We'll model these assumptions. We'll do our share our calculation and arrive at deduction. And towards the end, I'll also share with you how have I made sure that these assumptions are making sense, right? So a franchise for a quick service restaurant like McDonald's is generally granted for a very long period, and typically it is for 20 years. So that is the assumption even I have made. We'll take this franchise and we'll be able to operate the restaurant for 20 years. And other assumptions that I've made are, as mentioned here, some of them are on the basis of publicly available information, and some of them are from some news articles, Google, and so on. And then other are all, other wherever I couldn't find any reasonable source to get the assumptions, I've made my own assumptions. So ultimately, assumptions could also, I mean, could depend from people to people. If 10 different people sit and make assumptions, they would all end up with probably different assumptions, right? So I'll take you through what assumptions have I made, and then we'll model them. So what are my assumptions regarding the initial investment? So when we say initial investment, we mean the money that you need to put in to set up this business, right? So that is the initial assumption, initial investment that we're talking about. And what do you think, what would be the initial investments that would be required for setting up a restaurant? And if that is on a franchise basis, what would be the investments that you would require? So typically you would need to take a place. It could be in a very popular mall in the city. So you go and open your restaurant in a very popular mall in the city. So you'll have to hire the space over there. So that would be one investment that you need to make. You'll have to make a rental deposit for that. Apart from that, you'll have to incur on the interiors of the restaurant. So that would be another major initial investment for you. And we already saw, because you're taking this business on franchise basis, the another initial outflow that you would have to incur is the franchise fee, right? The upfront payment that you need to make to McDonald's for the franchise rights. So these are my initial investment assumption over here. So the requirements which I have noted down here is the restaurant area. I've assumed we would need a 3,000 square feet of area to operate the restaurant, and the rent would be ₹200 per square feet per month. So this is per square feet per month rent of 200. And the cost or the initial investment goes like this. So I would have to incur an initial renovation expenses of 12 million. So I have taken a little higher number here because I have not made assumption of further investments over the life of the franchise. So typically when it is a 20 years long franchise, you might have to incur renovation expense, say 5 or 10 years, every 5 or 10 years of interval. But to keep things simple and given the time constraint, I have assumed a higher investment upfront, so that we will not make any assumption of further investments over the life of the project, right? So the initial renovation, mostly towards your interiors, furniture, and equipment and all, would be 12 million. And the franchise fee that you need to pay to McDonald's for getting the franchise rights, the license to operate under their name, would be 3 million. And deposit for restaurant. So I assumed a 10 months rental would have to be paid as a deposit for leasing the area in the mall. So that deposit is of 10 months rent. So your 3,000 square feet multiplied by 200 rupees square feet multiplied by 10 months. So that gives me about 6 million of investment towards the deposit for restaurant. So all in all, these three are my initial cost which I would incur for this particular business: the initial renovation, franchise fee, and deposit for the restaurant, right? And coming to the last point here on this slide, so how would the funding be? On the funding side, I've made an assumption that 40% of these initial costs would be funded with debt. I would take a bank loan probably, and that would be repayable at the end of the franchise term. So this is again a simplifying assumption that I made. The loan would be entirely repayable at the end of the franchise term. So typically when you take a loan, you'll have to keep making payments on a monthly or quarterly or an annual basis. But again, to keep things simple so that we can finish it within the time, I've made a simplifying assumption that loan that you take today would be repaid only at the end of the franchise term, which is the 20th year. The cost of debt, which is the interest that you need to pay, would be 12% per annum. These are my assumptions on initial investment. Let's go and see the other assumptions that I've made. So the other assumptions are on revenue. First of all, the assumptions on the sales. So now sales assumptions are the most crucial assumptions in any financial model. So most of the other assumptions that we make in the model, typically, for example, for the cost-related assumptions, they would be linked to the sales. For example, some of the cost I would be computing as a percentage of sales. So if I'm able to forecast or make right assumptions with regards to my sales, my cost would also be meaningful, right? So it makes sense to devote enough time to make your assumptions towards the sales. So these assumptions that I've made here were made with a lot of trials and errors. So again, you might differ with these assumptions. You might have your own different set of assumptions here, but there are various ways of making assumptions. This is one way I thought is straightforward way to make assumptions for sales. So sales forecasting, as I told you, requires a lot of effort, and it's the most crucial part of the model. And typically when the modelers go and forecast or try to forecast sales, they would work on something called revenue drivers, right? So for a restaurant, it could be what are the products that you sell and what are the average selling price of those products. So for example, if I sell burgers, I need to figure out how many burgers units I'm going to sell and what would be the average selling price of those burgers. I might be selling 10 different types of burgers. So what is the average sales price and what is the quantity? Similarly, for wraps, for cold drinks, for ice creams, whatever I sell, I need to figure out the quantities and the price. So I tried doing that, but I found it a little difficult to get the relevant data. So what I did is I adopted this different methodology wherein I've broken the sales into two parts. The first one is the dine-in and takeaways. You can see it over here, in the middle of the slide. So dine-in and takeaways. And the second part of my sales was through delivery. So for a restaurant like McDonald's, typically they would have two kind of a sales which would happen. One would be the dine-in or takeaways, and then there would be a delivery which would happen. So I've tried to make the forecast of sales on the basis of this model. You could also make the assumptions of sales on the basis of products and average selling price, right? So let's look at the assumption that I have made. Shop timings. So typically the restaurants operate for 12 hours. The timings, if you look at the timings of the restaurants, it is 11 a.m. to 11 p.m. So they operate for 12 hours. I have assumed 80% utilization. So out of those 12 hours, 80% they would be effectively selling the product. So that leads me to 9.8 hours, I think, and that has been downloaded after 10 hours over here. And how many orders can be taken every hour? So every hour, I've assumed there will be 10 orders that will be taken. So essentially what I've assumed it that each order to be fulfilled, when a person goes to the counter, he places his order and he collects his items and comes back, that takes about 6 minutes, right? So each individual will take on an average 6 minutes to go place his order, get his item and get out of the counter. So that gives me about 10 orders every hour. So with that assumption, I got 10 orders per hour. And number of counters, I've assumed to be 3. And that would give us the total orders per day. So total orders per day is nothing but your hours you operate multiplied by orders per hour multiplied by the number of counters you have. So 9.8 or 9.6, I think it was 9.8. 9.8 into 10 into 3 would give you 288 orders per day. So in a day, a particular counter would bill 288 orders. And then what is the average sales per order? So I got the number of orders. I also need to find out the average bill that every customer would do at the counter. So I made an assumption of 150 rupees. So on an average, anyone who comes and places an order, his order value would be about 150 rupees. These are my assumptions for dine-in and takeaways. And that gives me the total sales of dine-in of 15 million. How did I get this 15 million? So there are 288 orders in a day, and each order would be for 150 rupees. So I would be operating my store. I've assumed that the store would operate for 350 days in a year. So 288 orders multiplied by 150 rupees per order on an average, multiplied by the number of days the restaurant operates, which is 350, would end up with giving me this 15 million of sales through dine-in and takeaways in a year. So that's from dine-in. Let's go and see my assumptions for delivery. So on the delivery side, I have assumed again similar working hours. So 12 hours is the working and 80% utilization happens. So about around 10 hours, a delivery person will be delivering food to the customers. And orders served every hour, I have assumed a lower number here, 3 orders, because here, unlike the counter, the delivery person would have to go and deliver the order and come back. So that would take more time. So only 3 orders can be served in an hour. And how many delivery vehicles do I have? I have 5 delivery vehicles. So total orders per day would be 144. Again, that is 10 into 3 into 5. That would give me 144 orders per day. And average sales price, average sales per order, I've assumed to be 150 rupees. And that would again end up the same, with the same formula of 144 per order, orders per day, multiplied by 150 rupees per order of sales, multiplied by 350 days will give me about 7.5 million of sales through delivery in a year, right? So these are my assumptions towards sales. And the other assumption that I need to make is, so this assumption of sales which I made, 15 and 7 million, roughly about 22.5 or 22.6 million, That would be the sales of year one. And post that, for the first 10 years, I assume the sales will grow at a higher growth rate, which would be of 10%. And for the remaining life, which is the next 10 years of the franchise life, the sales would grow at a 5% growth rate per annum, right? These are my assumptions for sales. Now, the next set of assumptions, probably the last set of assumptions that we need to make is towards the expenses, right? So can you guys put in the comment box, what kind of expenses do you think would a restaurant like this incur? Can you list down the expenses that a restaurant business would require to be incurred? What are all the operating expenses that they would incur? Please put that in the chat box in YouTube. What kind of expenses would a restaurant incur? Okay, some of you have answered rent, food purchase, salaries. Salaries, franchise fee. Okay, good. Cost of material, manpower and other overheads, electricity. Yeah, so I think you guys have broadly covered most of the expenses that we can expect to be incurred in a restaurant. Let's look at the assumption that I've made towards them. So I have operating costs and staff requirements over here as two of the major expense heads. So if you look at the operating cost on this side, the biggest operating cost for a restaurant is obviously going to be food. So the raw materials that they need to prepare the food. So the food and paper cost would come to about 40% of sales, right? So how I arrived at these assumptions, again, as I told you, I would be explaining it to you towards the end. How I justified these assumptions are reasonable. We'll look at it towards the end. First, let's finish the model and then we'll get into that discussion, right? So operating cost, one of the biggest expenses, as I told you, is food and paper. I've assumed it to be about 40% of sales. And royalty, this royalty is what we're going to pay to McDonald's, the franchisor, every year. And this is going to be 5% of my sales. So if I incur, if I generate 100 rupees of sales by selling burgers or whatever I sell, I would have to pay 5 rupees out of it to McDonald's as the royalty, right? So this is one other expense. And then I would have general and administrative expenses, which I've kept at 5% of sales again, right? The other expense which the restaurants would typically incur is the payroll and employee benefits expense. So I've assumed that the store, because the restaurant operates for 12 hours, typically they would have to operate in two shifts. So they would need a good number of employees in the restaurant. And I assumed the total number of employees of 30. So there would be 30 staff who would be there in the restaurant in two different shifts. So there would be two managers, two sales, six sales executive would be at the counter. And then the admin, two guys for admin related work. The others, 20, those others would include your delivery executives, your cleaning staff, and every other employee that is required at the store, right? So in total, there would be about 30 employees that I've assumed, which would be required to operate the restaurant. And I've also made an assumption regarding salaries of these employees. So the per month salary that I've assumed for a manager, 30,000 rupees per month per employee. And for the sales guys who would be standing at the counter is 15,000 rupees per month. And admin staff, I've assumed 20,000 rupees per month. All the other staffs, we take a assumption of 10,000 rupees per month of salary, right? These are my assumptions regarding the expenses. Hope all of these assumptions are clear. So now we're done with the first step, which was to list down all the assumptions. The second step would be to prepare the revenues, to compute the revenues and cost and get the profits, right? So what are the questions to be answered while we are building the model? The first one is, what is the initial investment? So have we answered this? Yes, we've answered it. We've seen that the initial investment would be towards the rental deposit, the interiors, and the upfront fee that you're going to pay for the franchise rights, right? So initial investment, we've already freezed. What about the second point? How is the funding arrangement going to be? Funding arrangement, we've already seen 40% is going to be funded through debt and 60% will be funded through equity. So that is again ticked, we've done it. Third point, what are the profits, cash flows from the project? So this is what we want to do now. This was the second step of our model. So we need to compute the profits and cash flows from the project. And the last point, what are the returns on this project? this is again something which we're going to do in the model now. So I'll go to my Excel file. Yes. So this is the file where I'm going to build my model now. And what I've done is, in the interest of time, what I did here is I've already prepared a kind of a template. So typically, if you were to prepare a model, that model would have to start from blank Excel file. You would not have any template with you. You need to start with a blank Excel file, and maybe with various iterations, you'll be able to finalize the template, right? Here, because we have the time constraints, what I've done here is I've prepared a template. So we'll compute the revenues and cost based on this template. We compute the profits based on this template. And then we have the cash flow calculations over here. And finally, the IRR, which would be helping us to make a decision, right? So what are these data on the sides? I've put the assumptions. I've listed down all the assumptions that we discussed in the PPT sometime back. I've listed down those assumptions over here in the Excel file, so that whatever computations we do in our model will be all linked through these assumptions. And later on, if you want to come and change any of these assumptions, let's say you feel, okay, rent should not be 200, it should be only 100 rupees per square foot, you can change this to 100 and your model will automatically get updated, right? So typically in a model, we already had a session by Daniel who took us through the best practices in financial modeling, where she had explained that you should link your model. There should not be any hard entering of numbers. So that is, in fact, the golden rule when you build a financial model. While you are computing your values, completing your template, you should make sure that assumptions are all listed in one place, in either in one sheet or in one place. And all the other places in the worksheet, wherever you put numbers, they should all be linked from the assumption sheet, right? So later on, if someone wants to, that would make your model dynamic, basically. So if later on someone wants to change the assumption and see what is the impact on the output, they can just come and change the assumption in the assumption sheet. Rest of the model will get auto-populated or auto-updated, right? So that's the golden rule. You'll have to link everything from the assumptions. So on this side, I have noted down the same assumptions, requirements, initial cost, operating cost, payroll and employee benefits, other assumptions. Yeah, I think sales growth we've already discussed. So useful life of assets, this is for computing the depreciation expense. I've taken 20 years, and tax rate I've assumed to be 25%, which is the corporate tax rate in India. So the funding we've already seen, 40% would be through debt, repayable at the end of 20 years, and interest rate would be 12%, equity would be 60%. So 40% of the initial investment will be funded by debt. The 60% remaining initial investment has to be made by the person or the franchisee, right? So we need to evaluate this proposal now. And at the bottom here, I've just computed the initial funding amount. I've broken that into how much would be funded through debt, how much would be funded through equity. So how did I do this? We had these initial funding assumptions over here. These are my initial investments that I'm going to make. Initial renovation, franchise fee, and deposit for restaurant. So I've taken these three numbers and multiplied them with the debt percentage. So 40% of that would be funded through debt. I multiplied it with this. That gives me how much of my initial investment would be funded through borrowing, right? So it comes to 8.4 million. And then the next thing that I've computed here is the remaining initial investment, which is how much would be funded through equity. So we know the equity percentage is 60%. So all those three initial investments multiplied by 60% would give me the equity to be invested. So this is the debt, this is the equity funding that will happen in my business, in my restaurant. Now over here, I've also listed down the same assumption that we saw in this slide for the sales. This is the dine-in and takeaways. So we had a sales about 15 million. And on this side, I have the delivery related sale, which was about 7 million, right? So that gives me a total sales of 22 million. Now, this is the template that I've created. First one is about the profit calculations. So here I've created a template for 20 years because we assume that the life of the franchise is only 20 years. So I've created this template for 20 years and we have all the line items here. As I told you, I've already created a template in the interest of time. So we'll compute the profits using the profit calculation template. And evaluating the also the office you need to compute your cash flow calculations. Yeah, so this is my template for cash flow calculations, and over here this thing called IRR, this is that capital budgeting tool which will help me make the investment decision, right? So when we come to this point, I'll explain you what is IRR. And finally, one of the most important steps in a financial model is sensitivity analysis. So wherein we see that if some of my inputs or variables are changed, how would my final decision or the final IRR that I've arrived at would change, right? For example, let's say if this model which I'm preparing, the most important inputs or assumptions are probably, let's say, food cost as a percentage of sales, which you assume to be 40%. If we feel that that is the most important component, and we would like to see if we modify that, how would that impact my final output? And also, if you want to, for example, let's say, see that if my sales growth is not 10%, but something else, and how would that impact my IRR? Then you can build a sensitivity analysis easily using a tool called data table in the Excel. So within a fraction of seconds, you can figure out under various scenarios what would be the impact on your IRR, right? So I'll take you through all of this as we come here. So just wanted to create a kind of layout a background on what template is about and how are we going to work around it. Okay, so let's start completing our profit calculations. So I would have to, as I told you, everything has to be linked from my assumptions. Nothing should be hard-coded over here. So where would I get my sales for year one from? I already have computed over here, this 22 million. So I link the sales from here, total annual sales. So that would be the sales for year one, right? And second year onwards, we know that up to 10th year, the sales will grow at 10%. And beyond that, the growth rate will be 5%. So I would go and link it from the assumptions again. We had an assumption over here. Yeah, sales growth for the up to 10th year is 10%. And then remaining of the year is only 5%. So let me copy this 10% up to year 10. And then 11th year onwards, the sales growth will moderate to 5%. Now I have declined it straight away from 10 to 5. If you want, you can also take a slow decline. For example, it declines by 1% every year or 2% every year and so on. So as I told you, these assumptions are all dependent on the person who creates the model. But yeah, at the end, we need to make sure these are all reasonable, right? So I've got my sales growth percentages over here. Now, based on these sales growth percentage for each year and the sales of year one, I can compute the sales of each of the years, right? So how would I do that? My year two sales will be year one sale growing at a 10% rate, right? So it would be year one sales multiplied by 1 plus the growth rate, right? So if I take my year one sales and increase it by 10%, that would give me my year two sales. So I've created this formula, I'll copy this and paste it across. Sorry. Yeah, so these are the sales that I will be getting year on year. So this is how it gets computed. It takes the previous year sales and increases it by the growth rate. So up to 10 years, it is going to grow by 10%. And year 11 onwards, the growth rate will fall to 5%. So you can see here, 11th year sales have increased by 5%. So this is my assumption of sales. And I've got the sales with me. Now the second line item that we have is the rent of the restaurant. So how would we compute the rent? We have the assumptions with us. Just link it from there. The area multiplied by the rent per square foot, and this is rent per square foot per month. So I need to take area into the rent per square foot per month multiplied by 12 months, because this is annual profit and loss which we are preparing, right? And rent, we have not assumed any escalation. We have just kept it constant for the sake of simplicity. So I go and paste this same rent across the years, right? So you see the rent would remain same because I'm not assuming escalation. Again, if you want, you can assume some kind of escalation probably after every 3 years or 4 years, right? The next assumption that we had was the food and paper cost. So we have these assumptions over here. Food and paper cost is only 40% of sales. Royalty would be 5% of sales, and G&A would be general administrative expenses would be 5% of sales. So let's populate these numbers as well in our P&L. So as we can see, some of the expenses are dependent on sales, whereas some of the expenses are not dependent on sales. So why is that so? Because those expenses that are variable in nature. For example, when we say variable, we mean these expenses will increase or decrease on the basis of increase or decrease in your sales, right? Now, my food expense, typically, it would increase or decrease in direct relationship with my sales, right? If I sell more, I need to also buy more raw materials or more food and sell it, right? So these variable expenses would typically be linked to your sales in any financial model. And then there are also fixed expenses like rent and salaries, which would be incurred irrespective of your sales. Whether you have a sales of 22 million or whether you have sales of 10 million, you would still have to pay the rent, right? The rent would remain constant. Similarly, the salaries would also generally remain constant, unless, of course, you want to reduce your capacity and lay off people, right? So these fixed expenses, I have not linked them to sales. I've taken them on the basis of different calculations, for example, square feet and number of employees. Whereas the variable expenses, what I've done is I've taken them in relation to sales as a percentage of sales, because these would all go up and down on the basis of increase or decrease in sales, right? That's the reason you can see some expenses are linked with sales, whereas some expenses are computed directly. Now let us link all these three expenses: food and paper, royalty, and general and food expenses from our assumptions here. So as you can see, these are all dependent on my sales. So I will put a formula here. Sales I'll freeze the row over here because then I'll be able to copy paste this formula below and multiply it by the respective cost. Right? In this case, I need to freeze the column because when I copy this formula in year 2, year 3, I don't want the C to move. C should remain constant. I'll freeze the column in this case. Okay. Now I think I can copy this formula and paste it for all the years. I should get the right numbers. Let's do that and check. Yeah, so these are my cost in terms of food and paper for royalty and general and administrative expenses. So royalty, as we already discussed, this is something that you need to pay every year to McDonald's out of your sales because they've given you the rights to use their brands and they will be innovating on products which will be selling, right? So let's just check for year two, are these formulas right? Yes, so year two food and paper expense is nothing but my sales of year two multiplied by the sales percentage, which is 40%. So this seems right. What about my royalty expense? This should be 5% of second year sales. Yes, I'm getting that. And finally, general and administrative expenses. Again, I've assumed 5% of my sales. So is that right? Yes. So we've got all the, because I've frozen certain rows and certain columns over here, I did not have to write the formulas again in each of these cells. I can just write the formulas in one cell and copy and paste it across all the years, across all these nine items, right? So that's how you can use the Excel to reduce your time, to save time while working on this. Now coming to salaries expense. So as we discussed, salaries is another fixed expense and hence I have not linked them with sales. We've computed it on the basis of number of staff and salaries paid to each staff, right? So I have these assumptions over here on this side here. I have the number of each kind of staff and what is the salary that I would be paying them every month. And that salary will increase by 10% every year. So let's fill these numbers for salaries. I would use a function called sumProduct here. So what sumProduct does is, it is going to multiply this 2 with 30,000, 6 with 15,000, 2 with 20,000, 20 with 10,000. And whatever are the results, it will add them and give me the number here, right? So instead of going and putting a lengthy formula of this into this, plus this into this, plus this into this, I'm using a sumProduct formula where I can select as many arrays as I want. So these are the arrays. For me, in this example, there are two arrays that I have. I have the number of staff and salaries paid to these staff, right? So what sumProduct does is, it does, so as the name suggests, it does a product and then it sums it up. So that is why the function is called sumProduct. So let me select the two arrays. This is my first array of data, the staff numbers, and the second array of data that I have to give here is the salaries to each kind of staff, right? So I've got number of staff multiplied by salaries, but we need to be careful. This is per month. So again, I need to close the bracket and make sure that I multiply it with 12 because we are doing it for a year. These salaries are per month. So is this, I hope this formula is clear. We have done 2 into 30,000, 6 into 15,000 and so on. And we've done a sum of it. That is what some product would do for me. And because these are monthly salaries, I've again multiplied it 12 over here. So this is my salary expense for the first year. Now, second year onwards, we have this assumption given to us that increment in salaries is 10% per year. So I need to increase my salaries by 10% each year. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to link with this. Just the way we increased our sales, I would also increase my salaries, but I cannot hard enter 10. I need to link it from here. So as I told you, why am I linking everything? Because later on, if I want to change this to 10%, if I want to change this 10% to 5%, I can do that here and automatically my profit will get computed accordingly. Right, so that's the reason we do that. And I need to, okay, I need to also freeze this B27 so that when I copy this formula, this link doesn't move. So here we go. Let's just check for one of the years if the numbers are looking right. Okay, so I've taken third year's salary and multiplied or rather increased it with 10%. Okay, so this seems fine to me. The other expense that we need to compute is your depreciation expense, right? So how would we get depreciation expense? What is the depreciation expense? So these initial expenses that we incurred, so I would not call this deposit as an expense because this would be refunded to us at the end of the franchise term, right? So this is not an expense. So here I would say that these two are the expenses. I will compute depreciation on the basis of that. And I need to depreciate these two initial costs over 20 years. Because life of the franchise is 20 years, so these initial costs will be depreciated over 20 years. Right, so this would be my depreciation. Now we've got our operating expenses and sales. Let's compute the profits. So my sales subtract all the expenses that I've got. That would give me the operating profit. I have lost for the first 2 years and then we get profits. So at operating profit level, we'll break even in the third year, basically. How would I compute the interest expense? We have the debt portion. How much of our total investment is funded through debt over here? So I'll take this and we can multiply it with the rate of interest, which is 12% per year. So that would give me the interest expense. Now, because we are going to repay the loan only at the end of 20th year, this interest expense would remain the same each year. I can copy and paste this. The next step is to compute the profit before tax. So it would be my operating profit minus interest expense. This is my profit before tax. Here I have a loss in first year. So the tax would be on my profits, 25%. So in the years when I have losses, I would not pay any taxes to government, right? So we can put a if function over here. So if this is greater than zero, then we would have to compute taxes, which means if this is not a loss, profit before tax is not a loss, we would have to compute taxes, which would be my profit before tax multiplied by the tax rate, which was 25%, right? The assumption for tax is 25%. Else, tax would be zero. Only if I make profits, I'll have taxes. Otherwise, the tax would be zero. And finally, we would compute profit, which is your profit before tax minus tax. So I got my P&L ready. Okay, so I had to freeze this tax rate. Let's do that. Yes. So this gives me my net profit every year. And let's now look at the cash flow calculations. So again, most of the numbers here are populated already because they are all linked from the various places. I'll take you through these cash flow calculations. So when we look at the cash flow calculations, we had to make sure that these cash flows would be year-wise cash flows, and year zero, we would be making an initial investment. So post the initial investment in year zero, we would have operating cash inflows towards the life of the restaurant franchise, right? So over the 20 years, we're going to get inflows. And in the initial year, year zero, which is today, we call it year zero because it is today, present, we'll make an outflow of this initial investment. So what I've done is the initial investment is in negative. So wherever you have a cash outflow in the cash flow calculations, you're going to show it as a negative. And wherever you have positive cash flows or cash inflows, they will be shown as positive. So our initial investment is linked from here. The workings that we did, the assumption that we made in the beginning. Yeah, so we computed that out of these initial costs, how much is going to be funded through equity. That is over here. Yes, so this is the equity that is going to be invested in the business. So here we have plotted what is the outflow that I would incur when I start the business out of my pocket, right? So this is the initial investment we make. As I told you, this should be negative because this is a cash outflow for us, right? And for the life of the project or life of this restaurant franchisee, I would be getting a inflow every year from the operations. So I've computed that over here in these two rows. So if you look at the P&L in this case, we have the net profits. And as I told you, profits are different from cash flows. So there would be non-cash items involved when you compute the profit. So if we eliminate them, we can arrive at the cash flows, right? So what I've done here is we need to go and check, are there any non-cash items in my P&L? So in this P&L, I have depreciation as one of the non-cash items. So why we call it non-cash? Because the cash outflow towards these assets or furniture and the franchise fee happened in year zero itself, which we've taken here. This depreciation is just a spreading of that cost. So we're not going to take this as a cash outflow. So to my profits, to my net profit, I've added this 750,000 of depreciation again, right? That would convert my net profit into cash flows. The other cash outflows or inflows that would be happen are at the end of the life of this franchise, which is the year 20, right? So at the end or the 20th year, I would have to repay my debt. So that repayment of debt would be an outflow for me. So that is one outflow which I need to take care of over here, which is this 84. And how did I get this? This is again linked from the debt raised that we computed, right? So the debt raised that we computed already when we started our assumption discussion, that 84 lakh or 8.4 million would be my debt repayment at the end of 20th year. And apart from that, I would get back the deposit that I made, right? So this initial deposit that we made when we took the restaurant on lease, this lease deposit or rent deposit would again be repaid by the land owner or the mall owner to us. So we would get back this deposit. So this is how our cash flows would look like. So initially you have an outflow, which is investment which you made. And then year 1, 2, 3, again, we have a negative cash flow because that was the year when we made losses. So you can see over here, we had losses. So that is the reason our cash flows are also negative. And 4th year onwards, we started getting positive cash flows. And year 20, you would have these two additional cash inflows and outflows that you need to take care of, which is the debt repayment and your rental deposit, which you will receive back. So if I sum up all my cash flows that I've computed here, I will get the net cash flow for each of the year. So from year zero to year one, year two, and year 20, right? So now I have all the cash flows also with me. So the last step that we need to do was to compute the IRR using the capital budgeting decision making tool. We can figure out what is the return that we are generating. Now, if I look at these cash flows, I might not be able to comment on what is exactly the percentage return that this project or this restaurant is going to give me. So what I've done here is I've computed the return that I'm going to generate from this project using this function called IRR. So in Excel, there's a function called IRR. This is a capital budgeting tool called internal rate of return. So this will tell you what is the return that you are making from this project on a yearly basis, So how do we compute this? There's a function called IRR. You type IRR and then select all your cash flows. So I've selected all the cash flows over the life of this project, right from year zero cash flow to year 20th cash flow, right? So we select all the cash flows here and put them in the IRR function. That would give you the return this project is going to generate for you, and that is 14.8%, right? So what do we mean here is this project is going to give me 14.8%, we can probably round it off and say 15% returns every year on the investment that I'm going to make into this project. Now, how would I decide whether this is a project that I should take up or not? I would have to compare this 14.8% return that I'm making with the cost of funds that I'm going to take to invest into this project. So let's say if I get money to invest in this project at 10%, which means cost of capital for me is 10%, then IRR or the return that I'm generating is around 15%. So I would be happy to invest in this project because I'm making a good margin there. So 10% is my cost. The return is much higher than that. So I would be happy to go ahead with this project, right? So that's how IRR can help you to make a decision. Looking at the cash flows, it might be difficult to arrive at a decision, but after computing IRR, you have something tangible to compare with. And with this, we can make a decision of whether to invest in this project or not. So that's about IRR. The last step, as I told you, we also need to build a sensitivity analysis in any financial model. So what I'm going to do over here is I would take my IRR of 15%, and try to analyze how this IRR would change if the interest rate percentage changes. If the rate of interest, in our model, the assumption is 12%. What if that rate of interest is not 12%, but it is 11% or 10%? What if that rate of interest is 13% or 14%, right? So if it is something else and not 12%. So under these scenarios, how would my IRR change? That is one thing we're going to do. And the second variable that I've taken to do the sensitivity analysis is the debt percentage. So the debt percentage, which we assumed was 40%, basically what we assumed was 40% of the total initial investment would be funded through debt. So if that percentage is not 40, but let's say if it is 20 or 25 or even 60, and with these combinations of rate of interest, how would my IRR look? So how would my IRR change? So we'll do a kind of a sensitivity analysis over here. And we have this function or the tool called data table in Excel. So the first requirement for you is to link this IRR that you've computed over here. While using the data table function, you need to link this IRR that you've computed here. And then select all these data. Select these data. And go to data. You have this what if analysis. Click on what if analysis. You can see these three options over here: scenario manager, goal seek, and data table. So scenario manager would typically be used when you want to change more than two variables and find out what is the impact on your IRR. So in our case, we are going to see if I change two variables, what is the impact. So for two variables, you can use data table. I select data table over here. You only need to give two inputs to this in this dialog box to get the revised IRRs and different situations, right? So the first one is row input cell. In our rows over here, we have the rate of interest. So what you need to do here is link in the model that you computed or in the IRR that you computed, where was our assumption of rate of interest? So our rate of interest was taken from here, this 12%. So I would link in row input cell, I have the different rate of interest scenarios. I would link where I had the base assumption, which I made while computing this IRR. Similarly, in our column input cell, we in our data table in the columns, we have the debt proportion. So we want to see if the debt proportion is 20%, what is the IRR, if it is 60%, what is the IRR, and so on. So column input cell, we'll have to link where was this base assumption. So our base assumption was 40%. So where is that base assumption in this model? So that was over here. And you press OK, you get the IRR under different scenarios, right? Now, the one that I've highlighted over here, 14.8%, this is the IRR that we got here, which was at 40% debt and 12% funding rate, or the rate of interest, right? So under different scenarios, this IRR or return that you would expect from this project would change like this. So for example, let's say if my debt funding is only 20%, I don't take 40% through debt, but I only take 20% through debt, and the rate of interest is 11% instead of 12%. The IRR that I computed, 14.8%, will increase to 17.1%, right? So similarly, we can see that under different scenarios, what would be the IRR? Let's take this one up. So if the rate of interest remains same, it remains 12%, but my debt funding or the proportion of initial investment funded by debt increases to 60% instead of 40%, the IRR would drop to 12.6%. 14.8 of IRR that we got in our base case scenario, that would drop to 12.6%. Right? So this is what a sensitivity analysis would do for you. All right, so I think we are done with the model building part. So I'll now take you and explain the last part that we kept for the end, that how did I make sure that the assumptions that I've made in this model are logical and are reasonable, right? So if you look at the McDonald's operations in India, so in India, they operate through a master franchise. So they don't give a franchise for each and every store or each and every restaurant. What they do is they give a master franchise for regions. So South and West, for example, is a master franchise with a company called Westlife. It is a listed entity. And the North and East zone are with another company. So what I did is this Westlife company, Westlife Limited, which is a listed entity, you can source the annual reports of this company. I went to their investor relations section on the website and got the annual report and took out certain data points from the annual report and tried to compare that with the output that I've got in my model. Right, so I'll take you through that part, and with that we'll close the model exercise. So over here, these are the data that I've captured from the annual report of Westlife Limited. This is the company which has master franchise of McDonald's for South and West. Right. So if you look at the annual report, I've given the source as well here. So this data is picked up from page 44 of annual report 2019. So if you look at this, I've got the data of sales and all the expenses for 2 years, 2019 and 2018. So this is all taken from the annual report of the company. And if you see the line items here, food and paper, payroll, royalty, the general administration expenses, these are more or less in line with the line items that we had in our P&L. So essentially when I designed the template for my model, I got the input from here that what all could be the expenses for my model. So you can get input using these kind of publicly available sources as well. So I've taken the 2019 and 2018 data here, and I've computed them as a percentage of revenue. What are these expenses looking like? So if you look at food and paper, for example, for 2019, they were 36% of sales. For 2018, they were 37% of sales, and so on. So you can do that even for, let's say, 5 or 6 years. So I've just taken it for 2 years for the time being. And on the side over here, column H, what I've done is, let me maximize this. Yeah. On the side over here, I have plotted the model assumptions. So these model assumptions are nothing but, as per our model that we just now built, what are the assumptions that we have made, and what is the actual numbers in the company's annual report, right? So for example, to explain that better, if you look at the food and paper cost as a percentage of revenues, we got 2019 and 2018, it is 36% and 37% respectively. So on an average, let's say it is about 37% for this company. Now, if you look at the model assumption that we have made, we have assumed that food and paper cost would be 40% of sales, right? So it is somewhere close to the actual numbers of this company. So that gives me a sense of certainty that, okay, the assumption that we have made are reasonable, right? So there are various ways of going and making sure that the assumption that we are making are reasonable or not. So in this case, because we had this data to rely on, so I've taken the inputs on the basis of this company's report. And royalty, if you see, for 2 years, I've got over here, 2018 and 2019, royalty as a percentage of sales was 4% in 2018, it increased to 5% in 2019, right? So probably it got revised to 5%, it used to be 4% till 2018, and in 2019, they revised it to 5%. So I've made an assumption of 5%. So similarly, G&A is 5% in our model. It was about 6% for this company. Operating EBITDA. So this would again be giving us a comfort that, okay, is our EBITDA in line with what is EBITDA that these companies see? So the operating EBITDA that they had was 9% for 2019 and 7% for 2018. The average EBITDA that they've got over the 20 years life. So these 9% and 7% are on the lower side because many restaurants are getting newly added every year. So over the 20 years life, the average operating EBITDA that we got in our model is 10%. right? So again, that provides me kind of a comfort zone. Okay, till EBITDA level, my model seems fine because I'm aligned to the results reported by the company. The other assumptions that we made, for example, the number of employees, the revenue that we are making per store, and the annual salary per employee, annual salary expense per store, I've again tried to validate them using the data of the company. So if you look at the employees per store, on an average, the company from 2016 to 19, I've plotted this data. The company has roughly around, let's say 30.5 employees per store. So our assumption was 30 employees per store, and the revenue per store average is about 40. So for in our model, if I take the average of all 20 years, that comes to about 53 million, right? So similarly, if you look at the salary per employee, I can justify it on the basis of this. So salary per employee, I computed it on the basis of the salary expense divided by the employee count. That gives me a salary per employee of about 1,52,000. So that in our model, the salary expense that we have assumed is about 1,56,000 per employee. An average annual salary expense per store is in this range, 4.91, 4.73. And in our model, it is 4.7 million. So many of the assumptions are looking aligned to what has been reported by WealthTech in its financial statement. So that gives us the kind of comfort that, okay, the assumptions that we have made are aligned with this, and the decision that we might be making using this particular model would not be way too wrong, right? So with that, I would leave the session back to Excel and Excel. That's it from my side. So we would be happy to take questions if any. You can put them in the chat box.
Thank you, Sandeepji, for such a wonderful session. We are moving towards our Q&A. I'm sharing you the questions. Sandeepji, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you for a wonderful session. I have shared the questions on the chat window.
Okay. Let me just have a look. Yeah, so I can see a couple of questions here. Let me take up as many as we can. The first one is cost of own funds is equal to zero. Okay, so the question I think is, why are we not considering the cost of own funds? So when you are computing your cash flows, typically when you make your capital budgeting decision, the cost of own funds, we're going to, as I told you, we're going to use it when we compare that cost with the IRR, right? So if the IRR is, let's say in our case was 14.8%, our cost of funds, if it is 10%, we'll go with the project because it makes sense, unless we have another opportunity which gives me higher return. If the cost of funds is more than the IRR, then we would not go with the project. So that is how your decision making would happen with the IRR. Right. So cost of own funds, typically the cash flow computation rules in capital budgeting is that your own cost of capital will not be subtracted to compute the cash flows. That will be taken care with the discount rate or the hurdle rate that you've taken here, which is the cost of capital. Right. What about working capital investment at the start of the business? Of course, so working capital investments would be there, not only at the start of the business, but every year your payables, receivables will come into the picture. So as I told you, I wanted to keep this model really simple so that we can accommodate it within the time limit. I have not taken up those assumptions here. Now, typically, if you look at the working capital assumption, what do they mean is there would be certain receivables, certain payables. I would also have to invest in the inventory when I start the business. So those initial investments should also take care of working capital investments. You're right at that. So you can incorporate those assumptions as well. But I wanted to keep things a little simpler. And this, as I told at the beginning, this is not a full-fledged financial model, right? We wanted to give a kind of a flavor or an essence of how financial modeling looks like. And this session is also being attended by people who are not from finance background. I wanted to keep it something that is applicable to all the audience. And that is why I've not gone into the technicalities of the accounting terms, right? So that's the reason I've not taken it. But you're absolutely right. Working capital should be incorporated not only at the start, not only at the initial investment, but every year when we compute the cash flows in our cash flow calculations, we should ideally look at the changes in current assets and current liabilities. And accordingly, our cash flows will increase or decrease with increasing current assets and current liabilities. Right? Hope that answers that question. Any opportunity cost to be considered for own funds? So the next question is there any opportunity cost to be considered for own funds? So the cost of capital, when we take that cost of capital, let's say we were saying that 10% is the cost of capital, that cost of capital would take care of the opportunity cost, right? Now, let's say your cost of capital is 10%. This particular business opportunity is giving you a return of 15%. There is another opportunity. You are saying it gives you 3% return. In the question, it is mentioned 3%. Okay, let's take the other opportunity with you. Gives you a 17% returns on the money that you want to invest. In that case, obviously, you would compare that I have this much of money. I can either invest. So if there's a capital ratio where you can invest only in one of these two projects, then you would compare it with your cost of capital. Okay, cost of capital is 10. Project A, the franchise project, is giving me a return of 15%. The other opportunity with me is giving me a return of 16%. So probably you might go with the best opportunity here, which is the opportunity B. We're getting 16% return and invest in that, right? If you have enough money, then it would make sense to invest in both the projects because your cost of capital is 10%, whereas the return from franchisee model is 15% and the other opportunity is giving you 16%. So both the opportunities are a positive return for you because for your investment of 10% cost, you're getting a return of 15% and 16% respectively. So if that is the case, you have enough money, you can invest in both. If there's capital wasting, then obviously we'll choose the best one, whichever gives you the higher return. So opportunity cost would again be taken care in the cost of capital. You don't have to separately subtract it while computing the cash flows. So there are a couple of questions around own fund cost or cost of capital. I hope this answers the question here. The another question is, what if the principal amount be during first 10 year in portions? Now, if I were to take a detailed session for you guys to build this financial model, most of the assumptions that we made here, kind of simplified assumptions, they would actually not be relevant because you need to do detailed working and then take them. So similarly for debt schedules, so when we prepare a financial model, in reality, we don't make such assumptions of simple assumptions of 20 years later you repay the debt. So as I told you in the beginning itself, that is a simplifying assumption I've made here. Typically, in a real life scenario, we need to prepare a debt schedule where you would have your opening balance of debt, then additions which happen to your debt, and repayments, if any, would be subtracted, you'll get the closing balance of debt. And your interest will be computed on the basis of either the opening balance, closing balance, or average balance of debt. Right? So, in our scenario, we need to prepare a detailed debt schedule where you can incorporate these assumptions that every year you repay some part of your debt, then how would your debt schedule look like, how would your interest expense look like, and all of that. So given here, we had to limit it for all the audience also, we need to make it relevant. And secondly, we need to also take care of the time constraint. So I've simplified it and assumed that you'll repay the debt at the end of 20th year. If you want to make a different assumption that every year a certain amount of debt is going to be repaid, then obviously you can go and prepare a debt schedule. You can add a separate sheet or maybe at the end of this sheet, you can prepare a debt schedule. And in that debt schedule, you can put your assumptions of debt repayment. So that will take care of impact of these different assumptions on the cash flow. The next question that we have is, what about the royalty? Is it not better to calculate on the net sales instead of gross sales? Of course, it depends on the agreement. So I think by net sales, you mean sales minus all the expenses. So yeah, as it is mentioned in the question itself, that would all depend on the kind of agreement you have. But typically, majority of the franchise agreements, they would not consider your expenses to compute their commissions. What they would do is they would take up the revenues and all the sales that you've generated, and they would compute the royalties on that. So that is how majority of the agreement would be. But that doesn't mean that every agreement has to be structured that way. So typically, because the agreements are structured in a way that the royalty is computed on the gross sales, you need to take it on the gross sales. Or depending on the situation, if you're analyzing a business opportunity where the royalty is to be paid on net sales, then probably you go and accordingly modify your formula for royalty there. Instead of taking it as a 5% on sales, you do 5% on sales minus the expenses, right? Okay, I have, one last question over here, which is, can you please walk through the sensitivity analysis again? Yeah, we can do that. So I will share my Excel and take you through that. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll delete this sensitivity analysis that we have, and we can do it again. I hope my Excel file is visible to all of you. Yeah. So the sensitivity analysis that I'm doing here is I'm going to vary two of my inputs to this model, and I want to see what is the impact on this output, which is the IRR, right? So you can take any two variables here. I have taken debt percentage and interest rate percentage. You can take out of all these assumptions that we have made, you can take any two assumptions which you feel are the most crucial assumptions for your model. And those two assumptions, you can do a sensitivity analysis on, right? So what we will do here is, on these various debt percentage levels, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40 is our base case scenario, at different levels of debt and at different rates of interest, we are going to see how will my IRR of 14.8% change, right? So as I told you, the starting point is you prepare this template. You can put any variables here and values for the variables you need to put over here. And here you need to link this IRR that has been computed in the model, right? So you can see I've linked this IRR which are computed in the model over here. For data table to work, it is very important that you follow these steps correctly, because if you don't enter this IRR over here, data table function will not work. If you don't select properly, for example, I have to select from here till here and then go and use the data table functionality. Instead of doing this, if I only select this area, let's say, and I go and try inserting data table function, it will not work, right? So these ground rules are to be followed to use this functionality of data table. So there are two things to keep in mind. First one is you link this IRR or whatever output you got in your model over here at this point, the intersection of these two columns and rows. And then while selecting the data table area for entering the data table function, you should select the entire area right from these variables, the input variables. Because the Excel needs to know what are the variables that you want to substitute for your base case assumption, right? So you select this entire area and then go to data tab. Under what if analysis, you have this data table functionality, select that. It will ask you for two inputs. These are the only inputs that you need to give, and your data table will get populated. So it asks you for row input cell and column input cell. Now, what is row input cell? In row input cell, you need to go and check what are the variables that are put in the row. Which variable am I modifying in the row of this data table, right? So in my data table, in the row, there is interest rate percentage. So you need to link where is this assumption in your base scenario. So my base scenario assumption was over here, 12%. This is what I've used to compute the IRR, so I need to link it from here. And in column input cell, I need to give the base, where is the base case assumption for the variable that I've put in the column, right? So the variable that I've put in column is debt percentage. And in my column input cell over here, I would select this debt percentage of 40%, because this was the base assumption that I did. And based on this, I compute the IRR. So I link it from here. And you click on OK. You see this data gets populated within a fraction of seconds. And how do you make sure that the data that you got is right? So obviously, we know that at 40% debt and 12% rate of interest, the IRR should be 14.8%. That is what you have over here. Right? At 40% of debt and 12% of interest rate, you get 14.8% of IRR. So this is what we have here. And these would be your IRR under different situations. Under each of these different situations, these would be your IRR. Right? So I hope this answers your question. Let me see if there's any other question. As I will pass it on to the next one. Yeah, I think we are done with all the questions. You've taken up all the questions. I hope I've answered them satisfactorily. Okay, so that's it from my side. My contact details are available on the slide. I would request you to connect on LinkedIn. So in case you're interested to learn more about financial modeling, you want to take up a more detailed financial model. I do take customized classes or online classes for financial modeling. You can note down my details on the screen and reach out to me for any help you need with financial modeling. Thank you. It was a pleasure to take you all through the session today. Hope you all liked it. Do share your feedback with me. Over to Excel and Excel.
Thank you, sir. It was an amazing and insightful presentation. We thank you for sharing your wisdom with us. I also thank the audience for the time and participation. Few announcements regarding our upcoming sessions. Our upcoming session is on 5th July, that is tomorrow. The topic is Managing Business Continuity and Finance During Uncertain Times by CA Shweta Kochar, followed by New Formulas in MS Excel and its Used Cases by Mr. Vijay Agarwal. The next session is on Rich Data Types in MS Excel by Ms. Paula. We are keen to know your inputs for our future sessions. Please do drop us your suggestions in the comment or chat section below. Don't forget to like the video, subscribe to our channel for more updates. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandeep ji. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, thank you, guys. How was the session?
Sorry?
How was the session? How did you guys find the session?
Yeah, I'll just...
Yeah, the session was really insightful.
Okay. I'm happy that you guys liked it.
Yeah, sir, would...